Good day to my colleagues and my friends. This is a short video describing how to recognize and manage crush injury. Crush injury happens, and in this day and age, what we have seen in the past few days, sadly, is about this massive earthquake that happened in Turkey and Syria. Usually the patients or the victims are trapped, so they spend a couple of days under the debris, not able to eat or drink, so they eventually become dehydrated. Also, the injured muscle that is under the pressure from concrete and different elements is inflamed, so it brings in so much fluid from the vascular circulation into that muscle and becomes swollen. And last but not least, and which is the most important, the muscle cell is damaged and it releases three elements: potassium, which is the number one abundant electrolyte intracellularly, so it releases that into the bloodstream; myoglobin, which is the protein of the muscles, and that is a very thick protein, and it's usually filtered in the kidneys and is very toxic to the kidney tubules, especially when it's concentrated or the patient is dehydrated; and number three is phosphorus, and I'm not going to talk about phosphorus, as the only problem that can come from high phosphorus is low calcium and could lead to hypotension. So how we diagnose rhabdomyolysis, this story is very classic and simple: a trapped victim under a building, and also the urine will be red or brown, and sometimes they are completely without a urine, and there's an elevation in the CPK, creatinine phosphokinase, and AST and ALT, both are enzymes that may come from the muscles. Of course, in addition to the elevation in the serum creatinine, that is a marker of kidney damage, but the marker of muscle damage is CPK and AST-ALT. How do we treat this? Time is of the essence. Time is of the essence. So the first couple of hours, the protocol that we are implementing currently in the southern Turkey and northern Syria is the first 2 hours are the golden hours. We resuscitate those patients once we have access to their IV, even if they're still under a building, still trapped but have not been released yet. We start IV fluids. They start normal saline at 1,000 milliliters per hour for the first 2 hours. So each hour they get a liter of normal saline, followed by 400 milliliter per hour for the ensuing 24 hours. And the purpose of it is, we know those patients are dehydrated because of the two reasons: they haven't been eating or drinking, maybe there's heat and there's sweat or different elements, and also the injured muscles will pull fluids into the injured area out of the circulation, so they become volume depleted or dehydrated. So we give them 1 liter per hour for the first 2 hours, 400 milliliters per hour for the following 24 hours. In the meantime, we're watching them clinically, neck veins, listen to the lungs, echocardiogram, or inferior vena cava echocardiography and evaluation. So what would be the reasons that are pushing us towards dialysis? There are only three elements that would force us to dialyze those patients. Number one, resistant hyperkalemia. Potassium of 5.2 is really not an indication for dialysis. If a potassium is 5.5 and goes to 6, 6.5 with EKG changes that we cannot control with our traditional treatments, like calcium, insulin, D50, bicarbonate, and so forth, then that is an indication for dialysis. If a patient becomes acidotic and we cannot control that, then that is time to consider hemodialysis. Last but not least, when they get pulmonary edema, respiratory failure from pulmonary edema, not pulmonary contusion, from pulmonary edema, then that's a time for dialysis. Elevation of a CPK is not an indication for dialysis. 100,000 CPK is not an indication for dialysis. 500,000 CPK is not an indication for dialysis. 1,000,000 CPK is not an indication for dialysis, neither AST or ALT. The rate of a rise in serum creatinine is not an indication for dialysis. Remember, creatinine not come only from chronic and acute kidney failure, but also comes from muscles. So when you have massive amount of muscle damage, you have massive release of creatinine, and that in by itself can be misleading and scary, that the creatinine went up from 1 to 6, so we need to rush to dialysis. The answer is no, that creatinine most likely is coming from the muscles and from the renal failure, as long as the three main elements, potassium, acidosis is under control, as well as the volume and somebody's oxygenating very well, dialysis is not indicated. I hope this can put all this disease in a disastrous time, like what we are living now, in a small nutshell, make it easy and simple to understand and simple to implement. Stay healthy and stay safe. I'm Dr. Rifai, the virtual nephrologist.